Hey guys, Clem from Honeybee Social, and today let's talk about something in particular that I'm sure is on a lot of small business owners' minds, and that is the impending recession that is due to hit quite a few countries, if not the entire world, because of the COVID-19 virus that is going around. I'm absolutely certain that there is a lot of small business owners out there that are stressing out and wondering what they can possibly do to keep the doors open. I mean, it's on my mind as well, as I am a small business owner, so I totally feel for everybody that is going through this stressful and, you know, albeit emotional time. But when it comes down to it, if you are looking at cutting costs and expenses and stuff, the one thing that you should consider not doing and maintaining, and if not doubling down, is your marketing efforts and your marketing budget. So here are three reasons why you should maintain your marketing through tough economic times. And then I'll also go over later on in the video a few things that you can do that'll help with your marketing efforts. So reason number one is that marketing is a critical asset. It is not an expense to your business. And a lot of businesses actually misunderstand this. They do believe that marketing is an expense because they spend money on marketing. And you may not necessarily be able to directly pinpoint where a sale has been affected by marketing. But the thing is that every single sale that you do has been touched by a marketing effort in some way, shape, or form, if not by multiple efforts, especially if you do a lot of digital marketing. So your social media, your content, your blogs, your website. If you are considering cutting expenses, you obviously need to be absolutely strategic. You need to look at everything from all fronts, but you need to especially look at where you want to be in the longer term instead of thinking of cutting your assets now, or you're cutting your budget now to help with the short term. Now, according to the UK's Institute of Practitioners of Advertising, they did a study in 2008, and what they found was is that communications, research and development, and new product development were all areas where increased expenditure during a tough time was associated with business success when those tough times really started to take effect. Now, what that means is that research and development, so researching into new products or new avenues of income, new product development, so if you've got a new product that you've been thinking about developing and you are developing it now, keep going, and communications, which is part of your marketing, were all things that if a business kept going or even increased their expenditure in, they were able to ride the tide of the downturn, if not be more successful. If they kept those efforts up, as you can see in this graph here, they did so much better. It's that blue line that you see compared to the ones that were in red and green. So green is zero advertising, so they completely cut their budget. If you see that they had a very, very long slippery slope to go back up in order to get back to the position they were in, or if they even halved the budget, which is that red line. If you keep up your marketing efforts now, it will benefit you in the long term. Amazon is a prime example, and absolutely no pun intended, on how new product development and communications, if they are maintained during a downturn, can actually help your success. In 2009, right in the middle of the GFC, what did Amazon do? They kept going on their product development of the Kindle, and they released it. And in 2009, they actually received 28% growth because of that product. Ebooks sold more than physical books in that year alone on Amazon. That's the first time it ever happened. Kindle was also not the only ebook reader on the market as well, mind you. There was also, you know, Apple ebooks by then. So that just goes to show that there is proof in the pudding in terms of if you keep going with your efforts, it's going to help you in the long term, even when times are tough. So reason number two is that market share and share of voice are going to be ripe for the taking. You are not the only business in your industry that is going through these really tough decisions. Your competitors are doing the same thing. And like many businesses, your competitors may decide to cut their marketing budget. What happens then during an economic time is if you have A, those companies cutting their marketing budget, as well as B, customers are being more frugal. You have a smaller pool of customers, but you have more opportunity to gain share of voice within the market. So this table here that I'm showing you right now shows this effect. It shows how in a good economy, that pool of customers is quite large, your share of market is pretty good, and your marketing efforts are pretty decent, and your competitors are the same. But in a recession economy, which is essentially what we're going to be going through quite soon, the pool of customers is much smaller. You've maintained your market share. Your competitors may have not, and your marketing efforts have also maintained. Your share of voice is going to be larger. And why is that good? Because when the customers, your potential customers, that customer pool has the money to spend, who are they going to remember when they want to purchase a particular product you're marketing? They're going to want to purchase it from you. Not from the competitors who have dropped out. Not from someone who has decreased their marketing efforts. They will want to purchase it from you as long as you maintain your marketing efforts and your budget. There's a great example of this from the Depression era, where there was Kellogg's cereal and Post cereal in the United States. Now, Post was dominating the market in the dry cereal market, and Kellogg's was not as big as they are now, but they were the second best competitor. When the Depression hit, Post decided, they're going to cut all of their marketing spend and all of their advertising budget. And what happened? Kellogg's swooped in, put in a ton of radio ads, they really invested in their marketing and advertising, and they became the dominant company for dry cereal, and it is still the case today as well. Another example is in the 80s during the recession, or a much smaller recession in the US, McDonald's, there was a competition for, obviously, with fast food, McDonald's, Taco Bell, Pizza Hut. McDonald's decreased their marketing efforts, and what happened? Their sales decreased by over 20%. They dropped by 28%. Taco Bell and Pizza Hut maintained and increased their marketing efforts, and Pizza Hut's sales exploded by 61%. And Taco Bell's was increased by 41% because of that share of voice, and that smaller pool of customers was there and they were ripe for the taking. So reason number three, the cost of digital ads is going to decrease. Because your competitors are dropping their budgets, because they are decreasing their digital marketing efforts, that means that digital ads on every channel, Google, Facebook, etc., will be a buyer's market. There will be more opportunity for slots to be filled in with your ads. And that means that the cost of those ads are going to decrease as well. So you just need to be a little bit more strategic, but you know what? It's ripe for the taking. Why would you miss that opportunity? And this will actually happen over, a long period of time as well. It's not that everyone's going to suddenly cut their budget. They may decide to start cutting their budgets in 2-3 months time, but you should see the cost of your ads diminishing. Okay. So now, hopefully I've convinced you that you need to stick with your budgets and just hold steady when it comes to your marketing during a tough economic time. Now it's time to how to rethink the marketing that you have to do in these tough times that are coming up. So number one, you need to consider maybe possibly pivoting your messaging a little bit. Now, don't be an ambulance chaser that's going to go and do fear-mongering tactics to try and get someone to spend money with you, because you know what? That just downright does not work. People become much more frugal, and the ones that don't, obviously they'll spend anyway, but the ones that do are going to be the ones that are going to be much harder to convince. And if you fear-monger them, they're going to be completely turned off. But that doesn't mean you should stop giving people value. It may just mean you need to pivot your messaging just a little bit. And telling your story is a great way to keep them interested. Show them that your doors are still open. Show them that you are still developing new products and that you are creating new products and you are still providing them value and you're showing them the love. Which brings me to method number two. Show your customers love and a lot of it. Now, I've already discussed before in a lot of my videos how engagement is key to being in the algorithm's good graces, for example, on Instagram, as well as LinkedIn and Facebook, so all the social media channels. But this is a time where you really, really, really need to show them the love. You need to show them that you are here, you have shown up, and that you are here to stay, and that you really appreciate them for staying. So this could be by commenting on your posts to every single person, even if it's a tag, if you don't do that already. It's showing customer testimonials to people that are being that more frugal and picky and going, hey, you know what? This customer absolutely adored my service. They loved my product. Here's proof that they really like my stuff and that you should pick me. Customer testimonials are an excellent form of social proof that will help people come back and love you. If you're in a physical location that actually is being directly affected by COVID-19, where you've had to shut your doors, or a lot of people in your area have had to self-isolate, one thing you can do is do Facebook Live events or do live video. So, you know, you may have booked a concert or, you know, some live music for one night, and unfortunately you're not able to show the public that. If the musician is still there and they are still open to doing it, why not film it and put it as a Facebook Live event and tell people to show up on your page to give that band some love, and they will give you love back too. That's one way you can do that. If you're a restaurant or a bar, you can also, you know, maybe you need to consider giving curbside service. That way you don't have people coming into your location, but you're still able to provide them the food or the drinks that they absolutely adore. And it also keeps them safe as well. They're staying within their vehicles, and you may be able to just place something on a table and they're able to grab it off of you if you can still do that. And third is pivot your offering. Now, some rules are in place for very, very good reason, but when there are rules in place, that is a breeding ground for innovation in a very, very good way. So I heard Duncan Wardell on a podcast, and he is the former head of innovation at Disney. And he had a really great way of thinking of innovative ideas that may help your company during an economic downturn or during a public health crisis like COVID-19. He said, write down all the rules that prevent you from doing something, or write down all the rules that your competitors follow by, and then see if there's a way that you can get around them or break them in a safe and legal way. Because simply saying, no, we can't, is not the solution. Simply saying, no, we can't, is preventing you from coming up with a creative idea. So here's a great example from Walt Disney. So when the very first Fantasia film came out in the 50s, he wanted to put in, you know, heat guns and fire guns and stuff to make it a very immersive experience in each cinema that the movie was going to be shown in. Of course, his team went, absolutely not, that is way too expensive. And so he thought, okay, well, how do I bring an immersive experience to the people that love Disney? So how do I bring my characters to life? And then he said, well, you know what? It has to be live action. They have to be in front of them. So I have to have Cinderella in front of people. But then how do you keep the Disney characters' worlds separate? You know, because you don't want Mickey Mouse in with Cinderella, or, you know, or for example, what was in the podcast was Davy Crockett and Cinderella. You don't want Snow White and Cinderella in the same place because their stories are totally different. And what ended up happening, what progressed? He came up with Disneyland. And Disneyland to this day is still the most successful retail giant in the world, all because of the way that it was set up and all because of Walt Disney's thoughts about, here are all the rules, how do I pivot away from them? So write down all those rules and then think of an innovative idea. A lot of us have time to brainstorm these days, so why not try it? We've got a lot of tough times ahead, but you know what? This is the prime time for opportunity. Let's all ride the tide together, and if there's anything that we can help each other with, here are all of my social handles so that we can get in touch and we can follow each other. I'd love to hear from some of you, and you know what? We're going to ride the tide together, and this is going to be interesting times, but you know what? We're going to come out in the end. I'm Clem, and hopefully I'll hear from you soon.
Have questions or need more information? Head to honeybeesocial.com.au.